remember, this journal is showcasing my slowly emerging into the fundamentalist world. Like I said last week, buckle up. But I find it really interesting that I've always been a seeker. In high school, I was really into Wiccan, and not really into it, but I studied a lot of it. I had studied, read a little bit about Buddhism, and then I sort of fell into this fundamentalist worldview. Like I said, I was looking for people to love me, but I was also using that as a barrier to keep love out. Like I've never been there, but the brochure looks nice. Jump in, let's go. Lay back, enjoy the show. Everybody gets high, everybody gets low. Or afternoon. It's actually afternoon right now, 12:33 p.m. A freshly afternoon. I guess what? I just recorded a whole 40 minutes of episode 24. That's what we're doing today. Journaling through the years, episode 24. I've recorded a full episode of it, and then I realized that my microphone wasn't set up, so there was no audio. And I was quite insightful and I had a lot to say. But it was quite long, longer than I think I should have done. So maybe that's why it didn't work out. So I will probably cut things back a little. So we are back still in our lovely Renaissance painting journal. And I figured it out. So in the beginning, I used it as, quote, an address book for all my camp friends from my last year of being a camp, which was my going into my senior year of high school. And then I had it, and somewhere around my junior and senior year of college, I started using it off and on as a journal. So it's still here. And then I never really finished it because, like I said last week, writing in a journal this small is really, really hard. I'm using a new mug this week, part of it because I wanted to shift it up a bit. And part of it because this is really cute. I was house sitting for a chihuahua and the people had gone to Mexico and they came back and they gave this to me. And then also I need to do a lot of dishes. So that's why. It's very full. I accidentally filled it too much. So let's begin. Let me take a nice sip of coffee. I hope you're doing well and that you had a really lovely weekend. I for surely did. For surely. I'm kind of watching to see if my landlord is going to come. He's going to come and look at some things, so I may have to come back to this. But let's look at today's entries. There's a lot of cool questions, philosophical, that's the right word, philosophical. There's also this letter that I found that was written by a teacher, and I read it, and now I'm realizing it was kind of boring. But it was, you can see it's written by a teacher, and this was from high school, though. And I think it fell out of another journal, and I need to put it back in that journal, so I'll just set that aside, and I won't worry about it. It's kind of teachery about a story. It was similar. It must have been a story I wrote somewhere that was based on a lot of what we're reading. all of that. So the first thing I start out with, now remember, this journal is showcasing my slowly emerging into the fundamentalist world. Like I said last week, buckle up. But I find it really interesting that I've always been a seeker. In high school, I was really into Wiccan and, not really into it, but I studied a lot of it. I had studied, read a little bit about Buddhism, and then I sort of fell into this fundamentalist worldview. Like I said, I was looking for people to love me, but I was also using that as a barrier to keep love out. Like, I can't love you because you're not a Christian. It was just a reasoning somewhere in my head. It was a protective device to keep love out, to keep me safe from actually connecting with someone. But the benefit of that fundamentalist worldview is understanding human nature and how that works out, and then also understanding another facet of spirituality. Deconstructing from Christianity, you would think that a lot of people that do that end up like, I'm a full atheist now, there is nothing. But for me, maybe because I was in it a shorter period of time, one of the ways I deconstructed is reading lots of other spiritual texts. So I read the Hindu text, Saramed Bhagavatam, and I've read other spiritual kind of new agey stuff along the way. I'm actually reading this right now. So I'm always reading these different texts, and what I found is that they all have a similar way of speaking about spirituality. And for me, what that says to me is that all of them are true, because there must be something beyond. There is a basic human need, wherever you are in the world, to seek after something, to find meaning, and to seek after something beyond. And for me, that says that there is something. And so that's what makes me continue to be spiritual. I don't want to proselytize. I don't want to do anything. I don't want to prove you wrong or me right. I don't want you to follow me. And like, I'm not going to start a cult yet. No, I'm not. But I find benefit in that aspect of my fundamentalist years, because I learned about the Bible and I learned about Jesus and that kind of historical aspect of it. And, you know, there is no way of saying that the Buddhists are right or the Jews are right or the Christians are right or anything. I don't think there's any way. I think, in a sense, they're all right. Which the fundamentalists would just look at me in horror, like I've fallen off the way, because they're always like, all paths lead to God is wrong. And I'm kind of like, I think it's true in a way. Because, you know, you can look at it as like enlightenment, all paths lead to enlightenment. It's all just enlightenment, God, universe, spirit. It all seems to have, it's universal to me now. It says the same thing. Just getting caught, you know, people get caught up in their own language, but it's all saying the same thing, really. It's just personal. So I start with all reality on and including the earth is created in our minds. Trippy, huh? I actually wrote that, trippy, huh? And I like that I was like kind of, I had that as a framework as I was kind of falling into this fundamentalist worldview, which would sort of corrupt and control the mind, but that was always my basis, has always been my basis. The next question is, what is attraction? I did not answer it, but I did draw a picture. Never good at that. I don't know if that defines the picture, if what is attraction, but I'm going to put these questions below and it's up to you to define them for me or tell me what you think the answers is. Next question. How do people internalize their perceptions of a potential mate's actions and reactions in their bodies and in their construction of reality? Answer below. Here we go. Here is a story. It's a true story something. Janie leaned up against the post of the bus stop. She pulled a long, red, juicy licorice out of her purse and began to gnaw at it. Her thoughts back to him. Her thoughts back to him. Her thoughts back to him for a moment. Then they fluttered off like the ever-descending years. So descending, it should be maybe ascending, because descending sounds like she's going backwards in time. Meanwhile, that's not what it is. It just says, then it has a line, and then it goes to this like next chapter or something. In his room, our hero, are these two stories tied? Maybe this guy is like causing her, like, is she thinking about him as he's causing her to go backwards in time? This is very like River Song, 10th Doctor, sorry, River Song Doctor Who kind of, one's going forward, the other's going backwards. I don't think that's what I meant, but let's just say, like, before that was even a storyline, the River Song and the Doctor. Although that started in 2005, and this was probably written around 2001. So I wonder if they were already, like, there was, like, an impetus, like, we should bring Doctor Who back. And they're already, like, you know, because it takes a couple years to think about casting and think, write the stories and get everyone together. So they were probably already thinking about it. And I was, like, writing something and putting it out into the world. Just kidding, because I don't think I was meaning descending. I think I meant, like, years were going away. But I like this story. In his room, our hero. Some guy is just our hero. But his name is Damn. Like, as in, like, damn it. D-A-M-N. Our hero, Damn. Played air basketball while listening to his Smashing Pumpkins CD on his Discman. Do you remember Discman? Do you remember CDs? I have CDs. So my car is an older car. It's a 2007. And it's a Kia, so it doesn't have a lot of bells and whistles. Like, I have to manually lock doors and manually roll down the windows. And then there's cars, like, my partner's car is a 2008 Dodge Honda, I don't know, minivan. And he has all, like, the bells and whistles, like, more. So it's just interesting that, like, one car from a similar era, decade, has less. But that's Kia. They're relatively new. And I like it. It's a safe car. And it gets around, has a good engine. It doesn't matter all the bells and whistles, but it has a CD player. And I had to go backward. Like, I had to go find CDs because all my CDs had broken or, like, I'd gotten rid of them. And I didn't go to a big CD store. Like, in the old days, I went to the Goodwill and they were like $2. And it was really interesting to me because I found all the CDs I bought that I was interested with that were from my youth were things like Alanis Morrisette, Sheryl Crow, Meredith Brooks, like those type of people. And then there was like Norah Jones and Jewel. And I always knew Norah Jones and Jewel. I was interested in that and Dido. But then it was interesting that I also really gravitated towards these other songs that I never knew I had such an interest in. But I'm looking at it going, yeah, I really like those songs. What is that, like alternative something? I don't know. It's like Alanis Morissette was the first one. And then the others were like knockoff Alanis Morissettes. Like they were like Alanis Morissette, but like she came out and she was like the big one. And then there were like Sheryl Crow and Meredith Brooks. I don't want to put those two down because they're pretty amazing on their own. But if you think about it, like Alanis Morissette was like boom. And then the others were similar, a little bit different. Anyways. Back to this guy playing air basketball, listening to his Smashing Pumpkins on his Discman. How is he doing that? He's like standing there, like he's got the thing with the headphones because the headphones went over and they were like here, and maybe they were like, well, I remember in like the 90s and 80s, they were like bright orange, a little orange pad that would fall off and then it would be like really metal against your ear and you'd be like, ah, and it went over your head and it was metal. Or by then there might have been where they kind of hook around, and whenever I tried to hook them around, they were like, I was like, how do you go like that? Do you go like that? I couldn't figure it out. But so he's holding it like it was a big thing. It was like this big, and you would so like, and then he's like doing one hand, and he's just like, why? Anyway, he was so preoccupied with his inane thoughts of life. So it's just like totally he has no purpose. His thoughts are just so inane. In the slow lane, he didn't hear his mother calling him and barely even knew she existed. Like, at all? Ever? In his whole life? Or just, like, in this moment? Until she barged into his bedroom. I love that idea. Like, she's got, like, a thing. She's, like, ramming speed, pushing dirty clothes out of the way of the door, screaming, "Get down here! We're going to be late for your niece's baptismal!" Well, first of all, I spelled niece wrong. Oh, he said, setting down his Discman and walking out the door. Very anticlimactic story. Just kind of, okay. I don't know, what happens next? Maybe you can tell me in the below what you think happens next. I'll add that in there as well. I'll have the questions and all that, and you can, like, fill the story, what happens next. Does he, like, pass the bus stop where the woman is eating the licorice and going backwards in time? I don't know. I thought it was interesting that she said, "We're going to be late for your niece's baptismal," because she would just say the name of the niece, like, "We're going to be late for Sarah's baptismal." But maybe she's trying to make a point. Your niece's baptismal. You're delaying us to this important life thing. I'm just kind of looking ahead to how far I want to go. Okay. I know where I'm going to go. My thoughts of you finger the pain of those lost years. Finger sounds like finger. Like, is that like an ET finger? Or is that like a sexual thing? Finger? And all my arrogance, I never imagined I'd lose you entirely. Like, lose you. Not even a memory to cling to. Except of, I guess, it looks like of she of shame, but I think it's of the shame, remorse, despair. No, sir. We never conquered our desire. Our desire, it conquered us. And then I wrote the saddest poem I've ever written. I don't really understand. I'm hung up on the fingering the lost years. And then the fact that there's no memory, but there is a memory of those horrible times of shame, remorse, and despair. I think I know what this was. Okay. This is this idea that, well, first of all, I'm falling into the fundamentalist worldview, which is always about, you know, you were born a sinner, and, you know, also it has this idea of, like, premarital sex is bad, like, and I already had at this point, so I was very shamed for that, and I had to continue to be this born-again virgin, but I, like, kept becoming born again. And so this aspect of feeling shame for your feelings, and then on top of that, as I'm going through recovery right now for various issues, one of them being codependency and relationship addictions, and I really want to highlight that in my form of codependency, there's a sense of relationship addictions, which means instead of being addicted to a drug or alcohol or whatever, I'm addicted to a relationship that's a salve to hide in. And however that would be, and I always want to kind of rescue that person and not look at myself and not care for myself and not love myself. And as I'm venturing into that, I'm looking at this pattern throughout my life of the sense of polyamory. And, you know, I always denied it, or, you know, I would outwardly say, no, that's bad. That's not the way. Because I was, you know, society looks at that as kind of, they think polyamory and they immediately think polygamy or poly-husbandry or whatever. That's totally different, and that's more hierarchical, like the usually the husband and then all the wives, and they're underneath him, subservient. Polyamory is lover of money. It doesn't even, lover of many, not money, doesn't even mean that you're going to go off and have multiple sex partners, just willy-nilly, just on the street, whatever. Not on the street, but you know what I mean. I personally consider myself also a demi and a sapiosexual, which means I have to have a romantic, or not even romantic, emotional and intellectual connection with whoever I sleep with or am intimate with in a romantic way. So I'm not going to go off and have like multiple, by the meaning I have like five different partners or something. But throughout my life, I've always like fallen hard for one person and gone into that being monogamous. And then maybe a year or so later, or even like at the same time, I also love someone else. And I'm like, you have to choose one. And I'm like, do you? I mean, I could never. And I did, because society and then also the Christian fundamentalist worldview said, you know, based on the Bible, Adam and Eve, one man, one woman, right? And I tried to believe that. I tried to fit in with society in general. I tried to, you know, do the normal 9-to-5 jobs, and I imagined that I was going to get married and buy a house and have a baby or more babies. And my life is not, I'm not meant to be that. I'm meant to be a person that stands outward, is a little crazy, and makes people think a little bit about why they're participating within society. That kind of inspiration to think out of the box, because that's who I am. That's what I am. That's why I've had all the, you know, that's why I've been on this journey. And so as I embrace that more and more, and I, you know, look at the last couple years since 2019, since an old friend slash flame came into my life, and I realized I have feelings for you, and I always have. And I did the bad thing then, with falling for my NRE, new relationship energy, thinking this is the one, I'm going to be with him forever and ever or whatever. And that's a form of relationship addiction. It's falling for, or that Hollywood Disney movie idea that I was raised with, a lot of us were raised with, that relationships, romantic relationships, once you get into a relationship, you are saved. That's your purpose in life. And that means that you don't really, you know, but then when things get hard, you know, day-to-day life, then you think, oh, well, this relationship has lost its magic. And it's not. Relationships take work and they take a lot of time. And, you know, that's why it's good to have kind of a foundation in self so you can find your own kind of, you know, love of self, be in a relationship with yourself before you get in a relationship with another person. But all along, and so now I'm trying to practice more intentional relationships as I'm looking back at my life and realizing that all my life I have been attracted to more than one at once. And it's, I always seem to be in a place where I am doing something that others in society, or advocating for something that others in society that are still not understood or not accepted. Like having a mental illness, I look at all the advances in the LGBTQAI, I look at in the even the Black Lives Matter and all these different things that are getting some momentum and getting awareness, and still having a mental illness, that's something that prevails across everything. And yet it's a lot of misunderstandings are there, or people use, you know, their mental illness issues as a get out of jail free card is what I've found. And they're not really doing the work. And I'm an advocate for people like that. Or they're looking at somebody that says they have a major mental illness and writing them off as whatever. So I've been that advocate. But then I'm also kind of voyaging into and opening up my idea about what it means to be in an intentional relationship. Like I said, right now I have, and since 2019, I've been trying to heal the wounds that I caused on the person that I've been with for now 9 years. So I'm really working at being intentional and giving him healing and just reconnecting with him. For the bulk of our relationship, I had a lot of other people in there that were more like energy vampires. And so when you have an energy vampire, it's like this, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me. And they get closer and closer to all you can see is them. And all you can see is them just taking from you. And so when I step back from those relationships and realize, you know, and kind of eliminated them from me, I was able to now start to see the people in my life that have been there in thick and thin, good and bad, and have support me, truly do, and I support them. And so I'm able to love them more fully, and that goes towards my partner that I was with for 9 years. And so I can't even speak. I'm giving myself to, giving myself more fully to, to him, and trying, well, not really, but trying to really invest in that relationship, as well as others, and be intentional with it, and have these monthly meetings, our connection times, monthly, every other month, however work life gets busy, and just really spending time and healing that wounds. The other relationship, I call him my partner, our feelings are there, but, you know, because of COVID and life, we don't always have the time to really invest in it, so it's not really officially, like, I don't know what it means to make something official, because that seems also very middle school. I think that a lot of times relationships, people haven't evolved past that sort of middle school element of you're my boyfriend, I'm your girlfriend, this is a status symbol. And I'm trying to break free from that, looking at it as a status symbol and actually seeing a person and not using them to hide in my pain. That's all I wanted to say about that. And basically I'm seeing that in my, so the person I was with romantically or linked up with status was this college boyfriend. I'm just going to call him college boyfriend. And he was abusive emotionally, mentally, and manipulatively. And it could have gotten physical at times, but it never did. And I was with him for 3 years. And I think up to the second year, I just wanted to break up with him. But I couldn't. Every time I did, he'd sort of manipulate his way back in. Until, like, one day, I was like, that's it. Like, he called me on the phone late at night. And he said, I'm going to move in with you, but I can only give you $100 for, like, right away. And then I'll see what I can do later. And I was like, no. And, yeah. And then I don't know. I was always afraid to stand up for him because he was so manipulative or up to him. And so I got her in another relationship and another relationship to sort of show him, we're done. And I would, like, avoid him. Like, I'd leave my house on Saturday and Sunday and, like, leave my phone at home. That was the dawn of the cell phones. So that he couldn't come over or call me. I'd be gone. I'd be gone all day. Because I just didn't, you know, and I would go to a cafe. And that was the dawn of that. And we'll discover that later. It was like 2002, 2003. But I couldn't speak up to him. And I thought it was, but I just couldn't. Because he was so abusive. So I had these feelings, or thought I had feelings, for a friend of mine from high school, from camp, from my camp crush. And so in one way, that was a way to avoid my issues with and be intentional in my relationship with this abusive guy, because I was afraid of him. He was also like an alcoholic and a, you know, drug addict. And he would like party on Saturday night and then, you know, get up and just like, whoa. And he could never keep a job, or I don't think he ever graduated college. I think he always just like, just stopped going to classes, and it was like, whatever. And I, you know, as an empath, I always want, oh, I can help him get better. I can help him get better at the expense of myself. So, yeah. So instead of investing in myself in order to say, hey, no more, get away. I just kind of went into fairy tale land of this other person. Now that's that issue. That's the relationship issues, the codependency. And that's a dysfunction. On the other end of it, on the other side, there's this aspect of polyamory, of lover of many. Now, I believe relationships are fluid. That doesn't mean that I am always, even though I have a prone to polyamory, doesn't mean that I will always be polyamorous. That means I can be monogamous. I can be in one relationship if it comes to that in that way. I can make that choice, and I have most of my life. But I am now looking at relationships in the sense of radical relationship. It's not even that radical. It's healthy, but it's different than what I have thought before, what everyone else thinks of it. I just wanted to bring that up. Here is... Well, before I ask the last question, I now have two arrows to these two places. I guess they have been my favorite pubs in my past life, or favorite bars, and neither of them exist. So the top one, JJ's Irish Cathedral Pub, was in Florence, Italy. Firenze, if you're really from there, and if you're true to Italian. And it was in the Duomo Cathedral, and had this great, like, little balcony. Like, you could walk up and just a little tiny balcony. You could sit there and look at everybody. And it was just not even that high off the ground, but it was so cute. I always liked it. It doesn't exist anymore. I had an Italian boyfriend for, like, 2 weeks towards my end of my stay there. And I found him on Facebook, and he and I were talking. And he goes, yeah, it doesn't exist anymore. It's, like, some weird pub. He showed me pictures. It looks gross. And then there's the Ashen Creek Bar and Grill, which is... here in Ashland, and it doesn't exist anymore. It had this amazing, like, deck that was, like, multi-layered, and it was over a creek, Ashland Creek, and it was just amazing. It was, like, the cool hangout back then. But then they sold off the deck area, and they put a big building there, and it's no longer the same at all. So I just thought, there was, like, why did I write those two pubs there? Life changes. They say that, you know, Ashland has become Californicated, but I think basically gentrification. So I have one last question I'm going to read, and then I'll read the other questions. And then in the about section, I will write the questions, and then I'll write that story about the boy that was going to his niece's baptismal, and the girl with the licorice, and you can tell me how it ends, or what's the next step. Why is it so easy to throw away old things that have long been broken, but so hard to cast off old feelings that have long been dead? First question? All reality, on and including the earth, is created in our minds. Trippy, huh? What is attraction? How do people internalize their perceptions of a potential mate's actions and reactions in their bodies and in their construction of reality? So those are the questions and the story. All of that will be down below in the comment section, and you can just answer whatever. I really want to know, because I don't necessarily know the answer, and I really want to know what you're going to add to the story. It's really fun. I did have someone respond to or add on to a story on an earlier comment, and it was really fun to see how they thought the story unfolded. So that's all for today. I hope you have a lovely day, a lovely week, and I will see you next week.
I hate the world today. You're so good to me, I know, but I can't change. Tried to tell you, but you look at me like maybe I'm an angel underneath, innocent and sweet. Yesterday I cried, you must have been relieved to see the softer side. I can understand how you'd be so confused. I don't envy you, I'm a little bit of everything, all roll into one. I'm a bitch, I'm a lover, I'm a child, I'm a mother, I'm a sinner, I'm a saint. I do not feel ashamed, I'm your hell, I'm your dream, I'm nothing in between. You know you wouldn't want it any other way. So take me as I am. This may mean you'll have to be a stronger man. Rest assured that when I start to make you nervous and I'm going to extremes, tomorrow I will change, and today won't mean a thing. I'm a